turn to a verse, a new verse really, for our consideration, in the book of Ephesians, chapter 3. I had a chance to speak to one of my brother-in-laws quite extensively yesterday, and his wife, my sister-in-law. They're also with Diane's mom. They're going back up to Rochester this morning. Talking about what I've been preaching on lately, and I actually, to distill it down, I've been preaching about the Father in heaven. I see him in these verses, and it's the he in a number of these verses in the middle of chapter 3 who's being described or pointed to by Paul. So I think in this day, we of course have Father and Son and Spirit, and a little knowledge of modern church history and experience of the church of late, I think would conclude that of the three members of the Trinity, the one that we right now are neglecting more than any other is probably the Father. Since the late 1800s, events in California, in our own country, in Kansas, a reactionary kind of movement to take some measures to lift up the Holy Spirit, because we neglect the Holy Spirit, really, we have been characterizing recent years. And we have the charismatic movement, the Pentecostal movement. In many cases, very good people who have taken the doctrine of the Holy Spirit, perhaps, and maybe carried it too far. Now, how can you carry something too far when it regards God? So that's a question. But what if you're carrying it so far that you're really finding that of the members of the Trinity, the one that is most prominent is the Holy Spirit now in many of our fellowships? That actually, that member of the Trinity that seems to want to be the least noticed in many ways. And then you think about, should we ever promote one above the other? Now we think of the name of the Lord Jesus. There, as the song goes, there is something about that name, yes. So there's something there. And as regards our salvation, all three are involved. But no question, the paramount one is Christ. And during his ministry, remember, he was very careful to try to promote everything and direct everything to the Father. But today, we are really finding ourselves downplaying the Fatherhood of God. So we've been preaching and concerning that. In Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 15, which we looked at for a couple of weeks, of whom the whole family in heaven and in earth is named. We preached in that regard and pointed out that that is referring to the Father. Now in verse 16, we have this verse. Again, the he here, the pronoun, is our Heavenly Father. Verse 16. That he would grant you, writes Paul, this is my prayer, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. Now there's so much to preach on in this verse, and this morning we're basically looking at the last three words, an unusual way to approach it. We're looking at, I think, what we need to do here, the last three words, verse 16, the inner man. And that is our topic and our goal. I was born in 49. I'm not rooting for San Francisco this afternoon, even though I'm a 49er. And I'm a 49er, but I'm certainly a Giants fan. Amen. How about the Giants? Those scuzzy Jets, I don't know about that. I root for everything New York. I root for all the New York teams. So I'm going to be rooting for the Giants this afternoon for sure. I was born in 49. In the 60s and 70s, those were difficult years in America. I was actually living in Chicago at the time of the riots in Chicago, back in the Nixon era, whatever was going on there. There was a reaction to many things. Ohio State took place, sort of what they call a massacre at Ohio State. There were riots in Chicago when I was there. I was going to movie at the time. It was an era of hippies, of a looseness in many things. Many of us look back nostalgically. Yes, it was Woodstock and things like that. Finding meaning and depth, I think, always hard. It was especially hard in the 60s and 70s. You know, there's such a, like, it's like dirt or soil. The richest soil is usually very thin layer at the top. There is much other things usually above the bedrock, but what you want is that very rich, rich, decaying matter that has come from the natural things. But it's usually quite thin. And what we have in our living today, I really think it's true of today, even, for sure, is that we have a thin veneer. I want to give an example from the 60s and 70s. I tend to read everything that pops in front of my eyes. I read car stickers. I've been talked about them here a number of times. I also read t-shirts. And I remember back in the 60s and 70s coming across a t-shirt that struck my notice. It actually was another language. I'm not sure if it was Italian or Latin or Greek or what from this distance. I can't remember. But there were two words that I recognized. At the top was the word Zoe, which, as it turns out, I know today, they even figured out then that it refers to zoological and zoos and really means life. Oh, I thought, this could be an interesting shirt. Because the next word was chronos or something like that. That's what I'm guessing it was from this distance. I knew it meant time. Somehow I knew it meant time. So we had life and we had time. I couldn't wait to, what was the next line going to say? But you know what? I couldn't translate it. So as I recall, I went to the person I saw wearing the shirt, or I either maneuvered myself so I saw the back of the shirt. Maybe that was it. You know what the next line was? I think Jerry Bedard does know. No, maybe you heard this story. The next line in the same languages as the others was Sports Illustrated. Now, I thought I had something before me that was an indicator of some profundity, something of character and advancement and maybe a little depth or refinement. And I thought, whoa, whoa, life and time. But then I find out the third line is Sports Illustrated. I've got just a list of magazines here. That's all it is. And what? I thought, I was a little disappointed. I've never forgotten that before. Remember the strangest things? But I've never forgotten that. I've always thought of that as somebody's personal statement, provoking and irritating, perhaps, view of life. Now, you can say such a person is carefree and humorous, but also I thought how I was tricked. I was looking for something profound. How little profundity there really is in many of people's lives today. That's from back in the 60s and the 70s, a time of real transition. But it occurred to me, it's occurred to me many times since, oh yeah, it's humorous, it's distracting, it's insightful in a very tenuous way, but it occurs to me, there is something more than this, isn't there? Isn't there something more to life than this? Now today, for instance, what's happening out in San Francisco? Whoa, some people out there in San Francisco have tickets to the game. Whoa, they paid a lot of money for those tickets. And can you imagine the tailgating going on out there in the area around the stadium out there? And this is quite an event, quite a memorable thing. Some people really love the 49ers and devote themselves to that team. Some people love the Giants and are out there watching to watch this game. They're going to be a part of it. It's the biggest thing of their lives. Too bad. Too bad. There are certainly more important things in our lives. And surely, there's something more than this. We just finished pre-Christmas, Christmas, post-Christmas. We have, all of us, I'm sure, contributed in a small way to America's economic recovery in the last few weeks. Oh, that makes shop. Therefore, I exist. I live, you know. That thought, so childish, so, I think, Californian in my mind, you know, so valley. Well, a valley thought, you know, I think, isn't there more to living than this? And the answer to that question is, there most assuredly is. So many people today, maybe you live for the weekend. You live for your vacation. As far as I can see in the whole entirety of the Bible, I'm not aware of anybody who took a vacation in all of the Old or the New Testament. Now, they did have holidays, and a number of days sometimes for those holidays, somewhat different than we do. That probably was their vacation period as such. But, you know, it's a tragic thing when the full meaning of our own evaluation as to our meaning and purpose of living is just downtime. That there's not something more important in our experience in our lives than just being off. And that the biggest thing to come is, of course, retirement. Whoa! Retirement! No. Aren't we here for something more than that? I've been listening to the radio. I listen to far more radio than I watch TV. And I've noticed an advertisement on the radio, some guy speaking about how he wants to leave this world, he says. I want to leave this world exhausted, he says. I want to do everything. And I want my last breath. I want it to be of utter exhaustion because I've been living it to the full. Extreme Sports America. Another skier. An obviously dangerous maneuver. Died. Shortly before that, one of the most famous extreme athletes in the world broke both legs. The same or similar kind of extreme sport kind of attempt. We have people who seemingly are directing our lives to things, may I say it? Oh, I know this doesn't sound very manly in America, in our world today, in sort of wasted kind of things. Amen? Think about it. Did you know that 200 years ago, nobody climbed mountains? It never occurred to anybody 200 years ago to climb mountains. And then somebody, I think, twisted, decided they were going to try to climb some peak and attempted to do so and did so. It has grown. I look at the adventure some people presume is their call from God, what they're to do with their lives. I think, is that what life and living is about? And I think, it ain't so. It ain't so. This is not what we're here for. Surely there is indeed something more that we are meant for. Question, isn't there more to our being than what is currently evident? I think so. The Bible speaks about that and uses the term the inner man. And our verse 16 says, "Oh, I wish that God the Father would grant you according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power or might by his Spirit in the inner man." You see, there is something else regarding our lives, something of some character that is different than our own flesh. In our scripture this morning, Edwin read a portion where there is some teaching regarding the difference between spirit and flesh. Which does God love most? May I say this? I believe he has and can handle a love for both the flesh and the spirit. But for you and I, our enemy is often our flesh. It separates us from God. It's disarmed our relationship with him. And Paul notes here and elsewhere in the New Testament a marvelous, happy truth that, frankly, our flesh is not the end result or the dessert of our being. best part of us that you know is immaterial. It is inside, and the word in the scripture really this inner man referring to the heart. Now we know today, and they also knew generally in that area also of time of Jesus' day, that the heart is an organ that pumps blood. What does it have to do with anything spiritual? Well, of course, it is a metaphor in essence for the center of our being. That ought to be the most important organ of our being. And so when we speak of God in our heart or as related to our heart, we're speaking of God as being at the center of our being, and the